Hi, everybody. I'm going to give one, the first of two talks on jazz and cognition, following up on a basic introduction last week during an informal conversation that I had. Because I'm not playing music that much anymore, I invited my friend Eric Sisoff to do the demonstrations for me. So let me read you a little bit about Eric. Most of you folks will know who I am. I gave a talk at the end of September on cosmopolitics and avant-garde art and philosophy. In the context of talking about post-human philosophy, and I was trying to show how many of the issues associated with post-human philosophy were already engaged in by the by modernist avant-gardists like Marcel Duchamp. And the trajectory of my own work moved from focusing on the avant-garde to then focusing on jazz as African-American classical music, and as an art form which Gilles Deleuze would call minotarian art. In other words, art from a subject position of marginality in society. And I suggested that the logics governing the polemics or the expression of art by the avant-gardists share similarity, particularly in terms of basic attitudes towards time that African-American musicians and those who have been following in that tradition have embraced. So, but first let me introduce Eric. Well known to local jazz enthusiasts in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Eric Sisoff, who's a composer as well as arranger as well as guitarist, has been part of the Pittsburgh music scene since his debut with the trombonist Harold Bedders in 1976. He's played with a long list of local and international luminaries, including Dizzy Gillespie, David Amram, Roger Williams, Erto, Ivan Lins, Roberto Lubombo, Charo, Frankie Avalon, Marty Allen, Eric Kloss, Frank Cunimo, Gene Ludwig, Pete Henderson, Dave and Maureen Budway, Sandy Staley, Kenya, the Brazilian singer who lives here in Pittsburgh, Roger Humphreys, Aaron Burkett, Kenny Blake, Walt Harper, Nathan Dace, Don Aligo, senior and junior, the arranger and composer John Wilson, and many others. His primary focus has been his Latin jazz quintet, Salsambo, which he founded in 1984, and they've recently released, I think, at least six albums. In addition, he's also recorded with Kenya, with Don Aligo Jr., Sandy Staley, Mike Tomorrow, the famous alto saxophone Richie Cole, who passed away recently, Azucar, which is a Latin ensemble, and about 60 other recordings. So let me just start there. He's also recorded, he's also performed with the Pittsburgh Symphony, actually had a 3-month jazz residency in China in recent years. So on that note, I'm going to start my slideshow and begin the talk, and then I'll interrupt the slideshow to provide Eric with the opportunity to be seen as he demonstrates musical examples that I'm talking about. So here, let me start this now. Share screen. So the title of this talk is investigating symposium that a foreign object organized is called Investigating the Relationship Between Sound and Time. What I'm talking about here is the relationship between culture and cognition. In order to explain why the different experiences of time and duration between classical music and jazz emphasizes that jazz is not a genre of music like rock or folk, or it's not just a genre of music, but it's also a unique regime of embodied and distributed cognition. And so I would suggest that that culture has had an effect on the shaping of the cognition of musicians that play within the African American cultural experience. And the way that I might can you hear? Is everyone hearing me? Okay. Yeah. Okay. So one way to explain what it is I'm driving at is to talk about the work of Edwin Hutchins, who started out as an anthropologist, and then drifted into cognitive science. And he's a MacArthur Genius Grant recipient for the work that he did initially on comparing navigational cognition between Western navies and merchant fleets and Micronesian sailors who are able to sail out of sight of land and be able to navigate for thousands of miles without a sextant, without a GPS system or anything. And one could simply describe that the difference between Western navigation and Micronesian navigation is that Western navigation is from the top down, that it's based on a worldview, or really a view that enables one to see the world from outside oneself and to superimpose order down upon that world. And the sextant and maps, and in particular GPS systems, which involve satellite navigation, satellite surveillance of traffic on the oceans, is very different from what the Micronesian sailors do. Now, Micronesian sailors would sail in these large boats, really wooden sailing canoes, very large. And they would be guided by shamans, and the position of the navigator within Micronesian society is really the position of a shaman. And they would actually navigate from the bottom up rather than what Westerners do from the top down. And they act. One of the things that they do is the shamans stand on the bottom of the boat with their feet on the bottom of the boat, and they can discern differences in how waves are hitting the boat, so that when the boat is experiencing deep swells, there's a certain rhythm to the way the boat moves through a deep swell. And when there are deep swells, they know, the shamans know, that land is very far away. Because when they also experience at different times roughness in the wave motion, so that there are what's called chop, which means really wave interference patterns, which are created by waves which bounce off of islands and then come back and hit those coherent swells. And they can read these, so they can tell where land is. And in the imagination of the Micronesian sailors, they're actually imagining that it's the islands that are moving and not the boat. And that's how they envision that. Furthermore, there is lore that is distributed among the culture, so that they know, for example, what is the radius of a range of different kinds of seabirds from landmass, so that they know if they see one kind of bird, they have to be at least this far away from land. If they see another kind of bird, they know that they're this far away from land. And furthermore, because of many journeys that these people have gone on, there's also the lore of what they will discover at certain points in terms of days and weeks of an ocean voyage, which enabled them to navigate for thousands of miles, much of which is without any sight of any landmarks at all to guide them. So this distinction between top-down navigation and bottom-up embodied navigation and distributed navigation, embodied in terms of how the shaman can feel the rhythms of the ocean swells, as well as the lore that's shared among everyone on board boat, enables them to do this kind of very accurate navigation. So that's the context in which I want to think about the difference between Western classical music and African-American music. And this comes directly out of the work that I presented last September 24th through Foreign Object on the differences in what I called, using Isabel Stenger's term, the cosmopolitics of worldviews between reversible time and irreversible time. And back in September, I talked about the modern avant-garde and its aesthetics and its embrace of an irreversible perspective on time, which enables an emergent view of physical phenomena. And now shift to the micropolitics of Minotaurian art, specifically emerging out of the condition of African-American culture. So, back then I talked about, and I'm going to not repeat everything I said last September, obviously, in order to cover more territory related to music, but there's a relationship between calculus and Western classical music notation. And the example that I'm going to use is Renaissance counterpoint. Here I'm summarizing what I'm about to do. And I'm suggesting that Renaissance counterpoint is organized in terms of the spatialization of time, which is almost identical with the ways in which the world is organized according to the principles of calculus. And then I'm going to talk about how John Cage deliberately deconstructed that form of classical music notation, and even in terms of the functioning of the musical instruments, by putting in, for example, rubber bands and tacks into a piano in order to disrupt the mechanism of the generation of music according to the laws of Western classical music notation. And then he began to deploy a form of geometry that is associated with irreversible time and thermodynamics called phase space. And I'll basically demonstrate how close Cage's music scores are to phase-based diagrams of thermodynamic processes. And then I'll start talking about phase space and the contingencies of emergent form in jazz improvisation, specifically focusing on the role of bifurcation in different dimensions of melody, harmony, harmonic rhythm, and percussive rhythm, which basically is very different from the determined trajectories of Western classical music and enables every moment in the process of the performance of a jazz, of jazz music to be a field of all possibilities at every single moment and in all four dimensions of melody, harmony, harmonic rhythm, and percussive rhythm. And one of the things that irreversible processes enable us to understand is the notion of emergence, which is my main interest, how order emerges spontaneously out of chaos, how this happens in physical systems, and what I'm going to argue that it proves central, not only to avant-garde aesthetics, but also Minotaurian aesthetics as well, and jazz is the example that I'm going to be referring to. So now I'm going to move to the next slide. Okay, so the difference The difference between classical and jazz is captured by the distinction between the precise mapping of the causal progression of musical form as represented in music notation and the ways in which the contingency of the improvised moment introduces difference to the otherwise determined trajectory of the song's narrative. This distinction is important, although mainstream jazz involves both determined mapping contingent improvisation. So there's the fixing of duration of melody, harmony, harmonic rhythm, and percussive rhythm in music notation exemplified by the lead sheet and the arrangement. And then jazz musicians cultivate the contingencies of possible differences that will make a difference, which then lead to spontaneous forks in the road in the trajectory of the music. And it's the embrace of those forks in the road that makes jazz music a field of all possibilities, whereas in classical music, there is basically just the determined trajectory written by the classical composer. Then there's an interesting process for jazz musicians and composers that during the composing process, these alternatives in turn become fixed through tape recording, transcription, recomposition, only to be fixed in music notation for further improvisation. And this captures the crucial process of jazz improvisation and composition. So what I would like to now look at are the differences in assumptions about how time works, differences in the experience of time, in the fixing of music into notation, and then improvising contingently in real time. So first, reversible time, the calculus in music notation. The calculus and standardized music notation emerge in Western Europe approximately the same time, and they share the same assumptions about time. In calculus, time is spatialized with time and space mapped on a grid with an XY axis. In that exertion of control over time, trajectory, speed, acceleration, and deceleration can all be plotted forwards in time and backwards in time. Examples of the use of calculus as reversible time: the movements of the planets, which make sense whether going forwards or backwards in time, the laws of physics apply either way, the movements of comets and asteroids, such as Halley's Comet, which is why we can predict when Halley's Comet will appear infinitely into the future and when Halley's Comet did appear infinitely into the past. And also, even with accounting for the effect of gravity and wind, in calculus, they can map the trajectories of projectiles like bullets and cannonballs and so forth. So the position of a physicist is like that of a chess player, freezing time for the purposes of operational control over the future. Renaissance counterpoint only became possible through a system of organizing pitch and duration. In other words, the verticality of pitch and the horizontal dimension of duration on a grid for the purposes of operational control over the independent voices through time and their implied consonant and dissonant relationships. So, Eric, if you can demonstrate in 1 second, I'm just going to read through. So in pitch and Renaissance counterpoint, the basis of composition occur with modes, and you can think of each mode as having a distinct flavor of sound, with brighter scales having the first half step after the third note and darker scales having the first half note before the third note. And I'm sure you've all heard of them: the Ionian, the Dorian, the Phrygian, the Lydian, the Mixolydian, the Aeolian, and the Locrian. The Ionian is based on the first note of a C scale, which is the scale that beginning with C. The Dorian scale is the C scale begun on the D note. The Phrygian scale is based on a scale from E to E based on the E note. The Lydian scale is based on the F note. The Mixolydian scale is based on the G note, the Aeolian scale is based on the A note, and the Locrian scale is based on the B note. And so it's from an octave, from the C, D, E, F, G, A, and B degrees of the scale. So Eric, if you could play through each of those, that would be great.
Okay. Ionian.
So you can hear the different flavors of each depending on where those half steps occur. So the bright scales are Ionian, Lydian, Mixolydian, and the darker scales are Dorian, Phrygian, Aeolian, and Locrian. So now I'm going to talk about Renaissance counterpoint, which builds a music of counterpoint of multiple melodic lines that are functioning independently and yet with according to very strict rules are coordinated with each other according to the principles of consonance and dissonance. And I would suggest that these features of Renaissance counterpoint are built on a rhetoric as well as a geometry of invention. And I'll repeat this once again to summarize, but metaphor and the principle of congruency is based is the basis for invention at the octave, in which the intervallic relationships or where those half steps occur are identical. Metonymy and the principle of contiguity is invention at the intervals, which is usually the third or fourth or fifth or sixth degree of a scale. And so because of the shift in scale, those intervallic relations shift slightly according to where those half steps appear in the melodic line. Synecdoche and the principle of scaling, which is invention by diminution or elongation for the duration of the melody of the melodic notes by one half or twice the duration. And irony, or the principle of inversion, is invention by retrograde all through the reversal of the temporal direction of the melody, where actually a composer will begin a melody, construct the melody halfway through the duration of the piece, and then because of this ability to freeze time, they will go to the end measure and then compose the same melodic line backwards, very much like the laws of nature, which apply to the movement of the planets, whether you're going forwards in time or backwards in time. So here we have four examples of Renaissance contrapuntal and invention. I'm not sure how this is going to work, but in the first example, there's metaphor by invention, and Eric doesn't have to demonstrate that. But in the treble clef and the bass clef, what we have an octave apart is exactly the same melody. And as you begin to see in this third measure, they're now harmonized together according to the strict laws of counterpoint, but they're exactly the same measure with the same melodic shape in terms of both pitch and in terms of the duration of the notes. The next one is metonymy, or invention at the second, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth degrees, where we have the basic melodic shape, but because it begins from a different degree of the scale, and here we have the first note G and the second note and the first note in the second line at C in the key of F, which means it's Dorian, G Dorian. And then this would be C mixolydian. You can hear the difference. And Eric, if you could just play the difference of those two very similarly shaped melodies, and you can hear the slight difference because of the different location of the half steps.
Okay. Sorry.
That's good. We would have to go on to see a little bit more where one particular half note would make more of a difference in that. But that would be an example of someone composing according to the strict laws of contrapuntal invention, repeating the second voice from the fifth degree rather than from the second degree of the F scale. In other words, Dorian in the first line and then Mixolydian in the second line. And then the next principle is synecdoche, which is invention by diminution or elongation. And here we can see that the second melody is twice as fast as the first melody. Eric?
Oh, all right. Two, three, four. Second line.
Yes.
Sorry, this.
Okay, good.
Yeah, all right.
And then finally, we're not going to use this as an example, but if you look closely at the melody and read the second melody on the bottom backwards in time, you will see it's the same melody as the top line. And that would be an example of Renaissance contrapuntal invention using irony as a rhetorical principle, invention by retrograde according to the principle, geometric principle of reversibility or inversion. So let's summarize. With the rhetorical trope, metaphor, invention at the octave, geometric principle, congruency. Rhetorical trope is metonymy, invention at the second, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth degrees, and we heard the fifth degree, geometric principle, contiguity, emphasizing the shift in the location of the half steps. Rhetorical trope, synecdoche, invention by diminution or elongation. The geometric principle is scaling. The rhetorical trope is irony, invention by retrograde or inversion, the geometrical principle of reversibility. Okay. So with reversible time and in classical music notation, we see it's the exertion of top-down control from a subject position outside of time. So this unites calculus and standard music notation. We can see that Renaissance counterpoint, its scales and intervals and the principles of control are the application of this ability to put time and space in a relational grid for the purposes of operational control. And we've seen how geometry and contrapuntal invention are united through the spatialization of time. Now we're going to talk about irreversible time. Which came as if any of you were here for my talk last September 24th, I talked about the anomaly of thermodynamics in the history of physics, which required a recourse to forms of mathematics and geometry, which cannot require total control over the history of the system. It requires both irreversibility of time and the use of probability rather than certainty in the trajectory of the system. And so there are two forms of entropy, equilibrium and non-equilibrium thermodynamics that I talked about last September. Non-equilibrium thermodynamics, which is a form of thermodynamics that involves order emerging spontaneously out of chaos rather than what most people associate with entropy, which is inevitable decline of the system. So then I will be talking about phase space and the insurrection of John Cage, and then talk about contingency bifurcation in phase space with respect to bebop, the use of double tritones and tonal bifurcation, rhythmic bifurcations, and moving from simple to cascading bifurcations in improvisation, and therefore get to free jazz from there. So with dynamics and thermodynamics, the precise control over dynamical systems enabled by calculus was incapable of comprehending complex processes such as the diffusion of gas or of entropic delay in what became known as thermodynamics. The Industrial Revolution can be described as the attempt to apply the laws of reversible time in the dynamic behavior of mechanical engines, which are capable of running forwards and backwards in time because they follow the laws of reversibility in order to control the irreversible processes of heat in order to produce work. Scientists confronted constraints on that control due to, one, the inevitable loss of heat and thus the power of the engine to perform work, and two, the inevitable wear and tear on the machinery itself, leading to inefficiencies and breakdown. Entropy is first construed to mean the inevitable decline of order into disorder. In other words, the Ferrari can turn into a pile of rust, but that pile of rust can never remember what it's like to be a Ferrari. In other words, it's an irreversible process. Eventually, a new kind of mathematics and geometry were needed to be created in order to account for those constraints and to help model attempts to eliminate, ameliorate, or at least limit those debilitating effects. That became known as the mathematics of phase space. Thermodynamics, or the study of entropic processes, eventually comes to recognize officially by mid-20th century that some processes are actually capable of moving from disorder spontaneously into order. These self-organizing or emergent processes are also capable of being modeled into phase space. One form of chaos theory emerges because of this discovery. So here's a diagram of a phase space model of future events. Now, instead of calculus, which maps precisely the causal relationship between events through time, excuse me, I get the hiccups for some reason. In this time-space axis, each dot on this diagram represents one possible future for the entire system. In other words, this accounts for probability in terms of the fact that there are multiple possible outcomes in terms of the probability of this complex system. You cannot map the trajectory of a complex system precisely with calculus, so therefore you resort to a form of geometry which can take into account the probability of possible alternative futures for the history of the entire system. Down below in the second diagram, you have these three blots, and what they are diagrams of a range of possible futures for the history of one particular system through time. And here, this maps from one moment to the next what those possibilities are through time. And you can see that there's a random, it seems like random movement, which indicates the probability and the randomness of what would be called equilibrium thermodynamics, or really the end game of equilibrium thermodynamics. So here we have a diagram in phase space of the aleatory or probabilistic drifting of the detritus of a biological cell which is disintegrated, and the parts are moving through time. And this maps what are the possible outcomes for the future of that disintegrating system according to the principles of equilibrium thermodynamics. And here we have the avant-gardist John Cage, who had already been engaged in disrupting the machinery of the reversible model of time at work in Western music by putting, rubber bands and tacks inside the machinery of a piano. And here he's composing musical scores according to a diagram, which is actually derived from phase space instead of classical music notation. Although you can see he's placed the treble and the bass clefs in there in order to show a relationship between the, or just to identify that this is actually a piece of music. But these random fields are indication for random sounds to be executed by those performing this concerto for piano and orchestra. And this is the solo section of that. So the above diagram is a phase-based diagram of cellular drift, and the bottom is a phase-based diagram for musical performance. So now to talk about cognitive bifurcation during jazz improvisation. So bifurcation is central to jazz improvisation. And by bifurcation, I'm just referring to the fact in the history of a complex system, there are sometimes forks in the road which lead to possible alternative futures, which is what those dots were in the phase-based diagram. But bifurcation in particular becomes important in non-equilibrium thermodynamics because it shows the point where a system that is disorderly can spontaneously move in the direction of greater orderliness, which is the work which made Ilya Prigozhin famous and by which he won the Nobel Prize in 1977. And I was fortunate enough earlier in my career to have interviewed him several times for my work on the dynamics and thermodynamics of culture and of avant-garde art. So, and we can find bifurcation in four distinct dimensions. And as a preview, jazz musicians are capable of processing in real time in all four dimensions at the same time. They can hear and anticipate bifurcations at the level of melody, at the level of harmony, at the level of harmonic rhythm, and at the level of percussive rhythm. So bifurcation is a central feature of emergent systems. So Prigozhin begins work during World War II on irreversible time and its role for describing non-equilibrium thermodynamics or forms of thermodynamics that move in the direction of greater rather than lesser orderliness. And so we will talk about simple bifurcations and cascading bifurcations. Simple bifurcations and a little bit more complicated cascading bifurcations, one could associate it with mainstream jazz, whereas cascading bifurcations actually provide a really nice way of describing what's going on during free jazz. So then I'm going to talk about just briefly, I talked about them more last September, but Prigozhin's publications in this relationship between irreversible time and non-equilibrium thermodynamics. And then I'll talk about individuation and bifurcation, which is a really important concept from the Stoics and medieval philosophy all the way up through Simondon, Deleuze, Guattari, and more to the present. So here are two diagrams. The top diagram is an example in phase space of a simple bifurcation where the system can move toward greater disorderliness, or it can spontaneously move in the direction of greater orderliness. Whereas in the bottom diagram, we can see bifurcations which trigger other bifurcations, which then continue to cascade, generating further and further a whole range of possible alternative futures, a whole range of possible futurities for the history of the system. So in here are a few of Prigogine's articles and work, which begins with his dissertation published in two volumes, the first in 1944 and then in 1946. By the way, he was a Russian Jew who basically grew up in Belgium, and he actually got arrested by the Gestapo for his work in the underground, in the resistance. And actually, Queen Elizabeth of Belgium prevailed upon the Gestapo to let him go because he had already achieved a certain renown as a physicist and chemist, even before he finished his PhD. So his work is not just associated with his most popular works, one of which is called Order Out of Chaos, which was published in 1978 and in 79 in France, in French, and in 1984 in English. In the stars here, he got influenced by the famous mathematician Alan Turing, who began to use nonlinear equations for describing these self-organizing positions, where he showed the mathematics for a chemical basis for morphogenesis, which is one of the principles of emergent systems that we notice, for example, in the development of fetuses. And then in this other one, which he co-authored with a guy named Balaskew, he actually predicted cyclical phenomena with thermodynamics, which leads to the idea of steady states, which do not move in the direction of disorder, but actually remain far from equilibrium and maintain a certain stability. And the empirical verification for that came first with the Belichov-Zabotinsky reaction, which was first discovered in 1958, and then the study was replicated in 1964. And then at the bottom, you can see the star time structure fluctuations. That was his Nobel laureate lecture on receiving the Nobel Prize in 1977, and it was published in September 1978. So, from the calculus of music notation to the contingency of emergent form, the role of contingency and bifurcation in improvisation. Harmonic motion in classical music begins with simple movement from the consonance of a one major or minor chord to the dissonance of a dominant seven chord back to the one chord. That's the most basic harmonic motion in both classical music and jazz. The dissonance comes from the tritone of flat five or sharp 11 interval, which in the key of C are the notes B and F. And Eric, could you just play the B and F so they can hear the dissonance of a flat five interval?
Or B.
Right, which then resolves to the third and seventh degree, of the third and seventh degrees, the fifth chord, which then resolves to the C major chord. And just play C and E.
Oh.
There. So go from B and F to C and E. Good. Perfect. The introduction of altered chords in jazz, specifically the dominant 7 flat 5 and the dominant 7 flat 9 chords, leads to a recognition that not just one tritone, but two tritones exist in these chords, which point to not just one or two trajectories towards resolution, which could be the major one chord or its relative minor, which would be C major or A minor, but four or more possible alternative futures. The idea that the instability of the dissonance 5-7 chord could serve as a contingent fork in the road leading to multiple trajectories, becomes the vehicle by which jazz evolves very quickly from the relatively static and modest harmonic resources of swing music from approximately 1920 to 1945 to the sophisticated complexities of bebop and then post-bebop jazz composition, and then the search for other forms of harmonic ambiguity that highlights a cascade of possible futures for the history of the musical form. This enables the introduction of polytonality, polytonal polyphony, polyrhythms integrated into improvisation and composition. We can now understand free jazz as the logical outcome for the embrace of contingent bifurcations or possible alternative futures in the history of the entire music system being performed. So, melody, from monologism to dialogism. For example, one of the features of jazz is what's called call and response, in which one person will say one phrase and then somebody will respond with a different phrase or just repeat it. And that leads eventually to polytonal counterpoint. Then there are also chord scale relationships, much like and actually deploying those same Renaissance modes, but moving from not just the major scale, but also the harmonic minor, the melodic minor, the diminished scale, the augmented scale, so that one could move from inside tonality or basically consonant sounds to outside tonality, which would be more dissonant, and also the reverse direction. So with harmony and bifurcation, we get simple bifurcations, as in the form of double tritones, with the 5-7 altered chord and the flat 2-7 flat 5 chord. And then we have more complex examples of harmony, which lead to which lead to multiple forks on the road, such as voicings and fourths, upper structure triads, hybrid chords. And then what we get are cascades, which exemplify free jazz in the form of polytonal sonic textures. And then we have bifurcations in the form of harmonic rhythm, such as the reharmonization of blues to Charlie Parker style blues to Coltrane blues, where blues musicians began to incorporate, for example, the chord progressions of giant steps and countdown into the form of a 12-bar blues. And then we have something like It's About That Time, a Miles Davis composition from In a Silent Way, in which you have the chord progression going through two times for every three times the funk blues bass line goes through, so that they're actually functioning independently of each other. And then they come into sync every six bars. And then the improviser can decide contingently which trajectory they want to follow. Do they want to follow the blues funk bass line, or they want to follow the chord progression? And I'll talk about more of that in a second. And then there's percussive rhythm, from syncopation to polyrhythms, and to a morphology of pulse as the inheritance of world music expands, which involves African rhythms, Caribbean and South American Afro rhythms, Afro-Cuban, Afro-Brazilian rhythms, and more recently from Mideastern countries like Turkey and Syria, as well as North Africa from Algeria and Morocco to Central and South Asian, and even Japanese. And all of these start inhabited. And what we're talking about with percussive rhythm of bifurcations, where we have different time signatures functioning simultaneously and working out in a way that they become complementary rather than conflicting with each other. And the jazz improviser can resort to either or jump from one to the other, as a resource of rhythmic structure in order to base their improvisations. So here, Eric, if you could then, I'm going to show moving from consonant to more dissonant, what these scales like over a basic C7 dominant 5-7 chord sound like, going from the most consonant pentatonic scale to the most dissonant pentatonic scale, and then from the most consonant major, minor, or melodic scale to the most dissonant. So if I could have you demonstrate those.
I'm trying to minimize this to get to my program where the chord is, and let's see, how do I do this? Exit full screen. Oh, there it is. Okay. So you're talking about C major pentatonic on a C7?
This is where we're at, Martin? Yeah, exactly. With the added blues notes. D minor. Okay, next, G minor.
Okay, hold on, let's start this again. G minor pentatonic.
Yep. Now E flat minor, F sharp major. Okay, so Eric, why don't you go from D minor to E flat minor?
Sure.
Alternate. Let's try a major mixolydian mode in C.
Okay. Oh, sorry, start this again.
Thank you. Now C Dorian. Now F and now C mixolydian derived from F melodic minor, and I made a mistake. It's there's no sharp 11 in it, just 9 and flat 13. Oh, yeah.
F melodic minor.
And now the last one,
which is
C Locrian derived from D flat melodic minor.
Start this again.
Okay, you can hear with both the pentatonic scales, okay, that's enough. Thanks, Eric. You can see from the C major pentatonic to the E flat minor pentatonic, we're moving from consonant to more dissonant resources, melodic resources, and from the C mixolydian to the C Locrian derived from melodic minor, we're moving from a consonant to more dissonant melodic resources. And all jazz musicians would be aware of the sounds that or the flavors of each of these modes and could draw contingently from any one of these scales or the melodic resources implied by those scales in order to build melody in over a particular chord. And to think that they're doing this even when the chords are going by very quickly. For example, in some bebop tunes where you get two chords for each measure and they have to process what notes are available for each chord, you can get a sense of how complicated and how many forks in the road are possible with respect to bifurcations in melody. So now we're going to use an example of bifurcation in harmony where we'll see a resolution from 2 to 5 to 1, which is the most basic form of harmonic resolution in particularly since the birth of bebop. And here Eric is going to demonstrate a two minor seven chord to a 5-7 to a one major seven chord, D minor seven to G seven to C seven to C major seven. And then if you could just improvise 5-2-5-1. Okay, now do D minor 7 to D flat, a 7 flat 5, which is the 2 7 flat 5 to 1. Now, Eric, play play the G7 scale, play the G7 chord, but then play the scale that you play over the D flat 7 chord. Good. Now play the D7 flat 5 chord and then play a G Mixolydian scale. So you can see that not only is there a bifurcation at the level of harmony, but then there's also a range of possible choices. And if you remember all the scales that went over the G7 chord in the previous example, the same range of possible scales could go over each of these two chords, the D-flat chord or the G7 chord. So you can see that not only is this a fork in the road in terms of the fact that they share a tritone, even though they are also implying different tonal centers, but that you could play one tonal center against another by using the melodic resources of one tonal center over the harmony of the other center. So that's an example of a bifurcation with respect to tritone substitutions. That's what that's called. So now we're going to look at voicings and fourths, which will sound familiar to those people that really like the late 50s sound of Miles Davis and John Coltrane. So now we're going to play a chord, D minor 11. Now this chord could function as a 3 minor 7 or as a 6 7 or as a 2 minor 7, a 6 minor 7 or a 2 minor 7. But there are three tonal centers which are implied in the ambiguity of this voicing and fourths, which is the ambiguity comes really from the openness of those voicings and fourths. So now play the chord and then play a B flat major scale, play the chord and then an F major scale, play the chord and then a C major scale. Okay. Now F major. And now the D minor, and now C major 7. So, and jazz musicians recognize that when they come across a voicing in fourth, that there is this ambiguity. And so they have a range of possible tonal centers that they can derive on in order to solo over this. And they can jump back and forth. They can decide to go up the scale in one scale and down the scale in, using another tonal center. So here we have a little bit more complex harmony, which is called triad pairs, where you play one major triad against another major triad. For example, here's an example of two major triads that are a tritone apart from each other. Play an E flat major triad and then an A major triad. Okay, now play the E flat triad as a chord. And then play the A major, and then play an A major triad. Okay, and now play an E flat 7 altered chord. And then try soloing over the hexameter scale.
Sharp.
play E melodic minor. Okay, great. Thanks, Eric. Okay, and here we have, for example, bifurcations in harmony and how songs evolved, particularly beginning at the bebop era. At the top here is a song called How High the Moon, and then the bottom is a song called Ornithology. The top is by Morgan and Lewis, and the bottom one is by Charlie Parker. And what I'm going to suggest is that in the process of improvising and exploring the bifurcation points, new compositions emerged that were based on earlier compositions. So if you could just play through How High the Moon. Now do Ornithology. It's the same. It's the same song. The same chord. Okay, great. So now I'm going to play these soundtracks, not too much of each, because I don't want to spend too much time on this. But here, for example, is Ella Fitzgerald singing How High the Moon.
Somewhere there's music, I'll play the tune. Somewhere there's
okay, and now Charlie Parker.
I apologize for intruding, but you have to share your audio in order for us to hear it. You have to click a box when you share your screen, which is usually at the bottom corner. And if not, we can't really hear your audio very well.
Okay, so that's an example of what happens when you have all these forks in the road for musicians to play with, and they generate new material based on the openness of the form, which allows for new possibilities to emerge. So, for example, here's an example of how through time, the forms of music evolved so quickly during the bebop era. So, for example, Charlie Parker begins with the lead sheet to the American songbook standard, How High the Moon. Over time, he develops a range of pathways for melodic variation and harmonic deviation while practicing and performing. Charlie Parker performs How High the Moon numerous times, spontaneously exploring the melodic and harmonic possibilities of the song in real time and in response to improvised accompaniment of piano, bass, and drums. There was an actual person named Dean Benedetti who accompanied Parker from concert to concert and tape records many of the performances of his song. And these tapes circulate back to Parker and to other members of the bebop community. Processes of recursion, transcription, distribution, and practice are disseminated throughout the community. A new composition emerges out of the distributed creative community so that a new song entitled Ornithology, a slight reference to Parker's nickname Bird, is committed to a lead sheet like the beginning of the process with the lead sheet How High the Moon. And various people have attributed Benny Golson and Benny Harris as the composer to Ornithology based on those tape recordings. And for example, one of the most famous songs in the jazz repertoire in terms of this practice in bebop are I've Got Rhythm by Gershwin. And you can find any number of tunes written on the basis of rhythm changes. Sonny Rollins's Olio, Miles Davis's The Theme and Serpent's Tooth, Benny Harris's Crazyology, Thelonious Monk's Rhythmining, Sonny Stitt's Eternal Triangle, Charlie Parker's Anthropology, Moose the Moose, and Steeplechase. Furthermore, song forms went through 2, 3, 4, sometimes 5 iterations, increasing in both melodic and harmonic complexity from one iteration to the next. And then the a logic of 2-5 chords that we associated, especially with the language of the American standards, we come to John Coltrane's Giant Steps. And Eric's going to demonstrate the chord solo of, so you can hear the melody. And then he'll play through the both the chords and the bass line so you can see how much more complex the song form is compared to the standards that the bebop musicians were using as the basis for their further compositions. Thank you, Eric. Welcome. So now we have bifurcations at the level of harmonic rhythm. Now, the blues is really one of the foundations of jazz, and the 12-bar blues is one that even the best of musicians, even in contemporary blues bands, still play. But we can see how there are bifurcations in actually the harmonic rhythm by the ways in which they begin to deploy new kinds of temporary chord progressions that are interpolated into the the 12-bar blues. Even to the point where you can say that anything could be a blues as long as you play the fourth chord, and everyone might recognize that a basic blues is a 1-4-5 progression, a 1 chord, a 4 chord, and a 5 chord, and they're all dominant chords, dominant 7 chords. So 1-5-7, 4-5-7, 5-5-7 chord progressions. So here's like the basic 12-bar jazz blues progression. Eric's going to play through that. Thank you. they now play a Charlie Parker blues, for example, Blues for Alice, one of my favorite songs. And if you remember what I was talking about before, every time there's a chord, then there's a range of possible melodic resources based on all the modes that will work for that particular chord. The more complex the chord progression, and you can see that while the fifth in the fifth bar of the 12 bars, there is always the 4-7 chord. You can see that he's taken, Charlie Parker's taken a lot of liberties in terms of the way that the chord progression goes within the context of the 12-bar blues. So now, as blues progressed in complexity and sophistication, given the innovations that John Coltrane introduced to chord progressions for jazz, people started writing Coltrane-based 12-bar blues progressions. And now Eric's going to demonstrate a Coltrane blues. Yeah, thanks. That's great. That's great. And so during the course of an improvisation over blues, for example, in a jam session these days, there could be several versions of this of a 12 bar blues progression going on at least for short periods of time simultaneously. So that the chord, the piano player, the guitar player will be playing one version of a 12-bar blues, while the soloist could be just using either a very basic, a primitive blues progression based on blues scale, or they could be incorporating Coltrane changes into the melodic resources, and it works. To do the whole song, all 12 bars. In two different progressions at the same time might not work, but they definitely do this in terms of short terms. So there are bifurcations in the choices of melodic resources that you can bring to bear, as well as the choices that the harmony player can bring to bear in the process of playing a jazz blues. And those are all possible, and it gives you an idea of really how complex and that the jazz musicians that are on the stage at that particular moment will recognize what it is that the other person is doing, because they will have explored all these different versions ahead of time. So this notion of simultaneous harmonic rhythms has actually been the basis of a recent PhD dissertation called Polycyclic Comprovisation by Trevor Coleman from the University of Otago in New Zealand. And it's this really long treatise on how there could be two or three or more simultaneous metrics going on simultaneously in a song, that different chord progressions could be going on simultaneously, and provides lots of demonstrations, and also some instructions on how to go about composing forms of music that require independent simultaneous harmonic rhythms. So here we have a song, a solo section from It's About That Time from the album In a Silent Way by Miles Davis. And this is a really fascinating multiple cyclic song where the harmony goes through three bars while the bass line only goes through two, which means that this song form would have independent harmonic rhythm for the chord instrument and an independent harmonic rhythm for the bass instrument going on at the same time, which come into sync every six bars, and then they repeat. And if you hear the solos from Wayne Shorter, from John McLaughlin on guitar, Wayne Shorter on tenor saxophone, and Miles Davis on trumpet, John McLaughlin soloing all of this will be concentrating on the chord scale relationships implied by the harmony, which is really almost like a 12-tone row. It's so atonal. While Wayne Shorter will begin with the chord progression, he then enters into an altered blues as he concentrates on the funk blues bass line. And then Miles Davis will alternate during his solo and actually go back and forth between the harmony and the bass in terms of melodic resources for his solo. So Eric, if you could play through the chord progression and then play through the bass line. Perfect. Now, I think I'm probably running out of time, so I should probably move on. But if we want, we can listen to the solo section of this song later, which I have on file here. And then we have the question of bifurcations in terms of complementary but independent rhythmic patterns, where you can actually have songs that have where the harmony player is playing in one metric, like 4/4 time, while the soloist is actually playing in 3/4 time. So Eric, if you could try to demonstrate that, this is kind of tough for one instrument to do, but he's gonna make an effort at this. Thanks.
Well, here's that rhythm track again. So if you're in 4/4, overlay the rhythm of 6 on top of that.
That's great, Eric. Thank you. This is, and in some ways, this is perhaps the most important in terms of bifurcations that a melodic soloist can do, to superimpose different kinds of metrics over the background rhythm section in order to create a distinctiveness while still being able to have it sound good because they're complementary rather than contrasting. So thanks for that, Eric. And now bifurcations in harmony, in other words, polytonality is compositional material. And here we have the introduction to a really wonderful tune by Herbie Hancock called Tell Me a Bedtime Story, in which the introduction actually exists, one could argue, in two separate keys at the same time. So Eric, why don't you play this? And here, concentrate on the fact that he's playing a G major 7 chord, and yet the melody note G sharp works wonderfully in this.
Okay, so the chords, G major 7, to F sharp minor. So what's happening is the melody includes this G sharp. Thank you. on the guitar. I only have so many fingers to play all this.
We're gonna have to graft. We're gonna have to graft another arm on you.
But yeah, the melody sounds great, and then the chords. It kind of just zings by. It couldn't be any other note. That would be in the key. Sounds bad. Sounds beautiful, though.
And the reason why is because that F sharp implies a chord scale which is distinct from the G major scale, and even distinct from G major sharp 11, which is a Lydian chord for the key of D major, because G sharp doesn't exist in D major either. So it's really A. So G and A major are coexisting at the same time. And that points, and the G sharp would also anticipate in the harmony of F sharp, which is the second chord of the key of A. So that's one way to explain that. But that's an example of the incorporation of bifurcations in harmony, polytonality in the form of deployed as compositional material. And for this, Eric doesn't have to perform this, obviously, because, you know, how is he going to play four parts at the same time? But I'm going to play this because it also harkens back and actually alludes to the way in which the polyphony of Renaissance counterpoint anticipates what became possible in jazz. So hopefully this works. And this is a composition, one of my favorite compositions. And actually, during my first iteration as a player, I used to play this song in my ensemble called Conference of the Birds. And I'm just going to play a little bit of it. And you can hear that he's really hearkening back to Renaissance counterpoint for this. And this piece sounds really good with lots of different instruments, but this really harkens back to Renaissance counterpoint, which is why I used it, because of the way that I set up this talk. There we go. Okay, I think that's enough. Thank you, Fidel. I really appreciate that. You saved my life.
It's weird that it worked, but that was a lovely
music. I really appreciate that. That's perfect. I'm going to stop my share now. And I'd like to thank Eric for humoring me on very short notice to do this. You survived and thrived in this environment, and you really helped make this paper. So thank you for participating in this. Eric was the person mostly responsible for me trying to get back up to speed after having quit playing for 30 years. And actually, much to his chagrin, he actually shared the stage with me a number of times. And so I owe him a lot. So you can stick around if you want to, but otherwise your task is done.
I'm going to cut out. I have to work tonight. I have a few things to do.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Eric, for the amazing performance. And thanks.
Eric, thanks so much, Eric. That was I loved your playing. It was a pleasure to hear.
Yeah, Eric is probably the most working guitarist in the city of Pittsburgh. Often 7-8 gigs a week, in a range of different ensembles. Aside from how many recordings have you done? 6 full albums with Sal Samba, and what, 2 or 3 albums with Richie Cole, and just
appeared on maybe 80 albums lifetime, but yeah, a lot of things, especially since Pittsburgh's not a recording hub, you might say.
Yeah.
But yeah, I get my share.
Yeah.
Nice.
So thank you, Eric.
Thank you. And nice to meet you. And thanks for having me. It was very interesting, Martin.
Well, thanks for putting up with it.
Okay.
Well, thanks, Eric. Lovely playing.
Thank you. Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Now, do you guys want to take a break? I mean, it's already 2:40, so I'm happy to continue, but what do you folks want to do?
Yeah, we can continue, Martin. Yes, for sure.
Okay.
So if the only thing is, let's start with the questions and comments. And if you can turn on your cameras, unfortunately, I cannot turn on my camera right now, but feel free if you can. It helps Martin to have a better environment. Okay, Martin, pass it to you.
Yeah, are there any questions that people might have?
I've got kind of a question, and thanks for this, Martin. It was I've read some of this material in your published work, but it was lovely to hear you talk through it with the Eric's accompaniment.
Well, the fact that it was a lot shorter than the written version of this, which was like what?
Yeah, 96, and also
96 pages.
Yeah, there are also a kind of few. I realize there are kind of few scales and harmonic ideas I need to try out for myself, but that's kind of irrelevant to what.
And you can imagine that I was. I wanted to show how fundamentally different jazz musicians experience the world in time than the rest of us do. Westerners, Europeans in particular, and we can try to learn that way of functioning, but it's rooted in culture. In order to try to explain this, I had to begin with the simplest things first. This is just scratching the surface of what jazz musicians are into.
Beautifully organized, actually. I guess there's one thing that I was thinking about while I was listening, and I'd been reading some work on Deleuze and Hegel earlier today, I don't know what you think, but it does seem to me that that at least when it comes to this kind of we do seem to be talking about a kind of cognition here when we're talking about what jazz musicians do. It's not kind of explicit formal computational. Well, it might be computational, but not.
Well, that's the difference between practice room and on the bandstand.
Yeah, but I mean, it does seem to me that a lot of what the kind of cognition that's going on is in some sense not representational. It's sub-representational, because by virtue of the fact that jazz musicians have to deal very quickly with kind of points of indeterminacy, for example, in a harmonic context, where as you point out. You know, I might be playing over a G pedal point, you know, kind of simple G. You know, my bass player might be playing my keyboard isn't plugged in at the moment, but might be playing a simple kind of bass note. But over that, I could overlay say a D minor pentatonic, a superlocrian, you know, to introduce kind of different harmonic possibilities, and there's nothing that prescribes any of those.
Yeah, superlocrian
I think it's actually a form of the harmonic. It's actually, you talking about, it's a form of the harmonic, it's a mode of the harmonic minor, from what I remember.
And also, and melodic minor too.
Melodic minor. So, you know, if I was playing over, if I was playing over a D major seven chord, I might interpret that just as a straight D seven chord and play, D Mixolydian or a D blues, or I might alter it to a D sharp ninth chord, which again would introduce these two tritones, and over that I might overlay something like a supralocrian or diminished scales or something like that. But there's nothing that prescribes any of these. It's kind of something you feel, you it's embodied, but it is a kind of thinking. And I guess I maybe this isn't the question, but it does suggest to me that in order to, it's kind of salutary, I guess, to bear in mind that we are talking about cognition, but it's not it doesn't seem to be the kind of cognition that could be sort of formalized in sort of linguistic terms. I mean, you might be able to kind of write a program to do some of this, but actually what we're doing it doesn't seem to be formalizable in this sense. I mean, I'm sure you can get AIs to do something, like, for example, a recurrent neural network, for example, might be able to do some of what we're talking about.
Yeah. Well, my talk next Saturday will directly address this in terms of distributed cognition, which is really what I want to do, is just how this happens. And one of the things that your approach implies is intentionality. And when you're dealing with the subject as a multiplicity, with simultaneous cognitive processes coexisting, sometimes at cross purposes, then that complicates the process.
Yeah.
And then there's the question of what I call the relationship between flow and groove in of a continuum.
Yeah.
Beneath that, everyone feels, and it's at the level of feeling, and that somehow that continuum is enables these bifurcations to occur. I'm not really attempting to metaphysicalize it, but there is some kind of spontaneous creative impulse which comes out of that groove.
I mean, I think it does. You're right, though. I mean, I think it probably does at some point down the road raise metaphysical questions.
Absolutely, yeah. Or I would argue that people like Bergson, who were thinking about this, aren't really metaphysicians, but they're really materialists.
Yeah, but I wonder if it's helpful to make a distinction in terms of intentionality. I think Merleau-Ponty makes this distinction between longitudinal and vertical intentionality. So vertical intentionality is roughly intentionality which is informed by some kind of conceptual grasp or representational grasp, at least, of what you're experiencing. For example, it might be looking at a visual image of some kind, or a box or a tree or whatever, whereas longitudinal intentionality is kind of is much more linked to our experience of time and embodied the embodied flux of our movement through the world, you know. Yeah. So I guess fractured into these kind of larval kind of movements.
Yeah, well, that's why I hope that you show up next week, because, you know, the essay jazz narrative directly raises the question of intentionality in this context, particularly when you're dealing with a multiplicity of time cognitions existing simultaneously.
Yeah, what we actually mean by intentionality, what we mean by intentionality, given it can be as complex and, as you say, multivalent as this.
But if I raise the question of intentionality and you as the real philosopher will then provide a variety of answers?
Okay, it'll give me something to occupy my time till next Saturday. Yeah. That's brilliant. Yeah. Thanks again, Martin, and obviously also to Eric, because as a sometime jazz musician, I was getting a lot of pleasure out of the
Eric is amazing. He's amazing.
Yeah, lovely. I'm glad you didn't ask me to do that. I screwed up. Yeah,
I intended to do it myself, but I just can't play these days. Now I got two questions from Renzo and Sorosh, but let's come back to you maybe a little bit later. Renzo, did you want to?
Yeah, thank you, Martin. My question is kind of similar from David's question, and it's related how you see it. The bifurcation that you mentioned in all your speech related to tacit engagement in the sense of embodiment of know how, know that, and know when, knowing when. In these three variations of knowing in this improvisation moments, because when I watch some improvisation concerts from improvisers, I can see that is implicit this tacit engagement many moments that they don't, that is, I don't know how to explain. You mentioned Simone Don in some moment, there's a pre-individual after the constitution, the informational aspect comes to this moment of realize something, but it's more in intuition. That is the aspect of intuition versus predictional. You know, how do you see the bifurcation in this aspect of intuition and prediction in this knowing aspects of when you are playing in this moments of improvisation, because I see in this game these two aspects, intuitional and predictable.
In my opinion, I think jazz musicians know something that the rest of us need to understand. And this coming Saturday, I will talk about the neurophenomenology of jazz improvisation, because that's really, I think, what you're getting at. I was having a little bit of a hard time understanding what you were saying, but I think I got the gist of it. And, the moment of emergence is really what I'm talking about. And I was trying to describe the extrinsic manifestations of emergence in jazz, which are visible in music notation. And this coming Saturday, I'll be talking about the cognitive neuroscience of improvisation and the fact that when one practices, one has a certain style of cognition necessary for operational control, but that control must be relinquished in the moment And also to explain that what being in the moment, which is a kind of a cliche among jazz musicians, is actually fraught with all kinds of complications that need to be addressed. In the essay, Jazz's Narrative, I try to come to terms with those questions, certainly not definitively, but as a beginning from my entry into these issues. And then there's also the micro-political implications of all this, which I'm hoping to wait until October 4th in the essay, The Gift of Silence, where I would like to address, you know, what are the cognitive, what are the micro-political implications of cognitive bifurcation in an epoch where there are systems, social systems, digital systems, which are actually impinging on processes of bifurcation at the level of cognition for all of humanity. And so, in other words, I want to see jazz as a kind of neuroresistance. Jazz improvisation is a form of neuroresistance which decentralizes by relinquishing executive control, to use a term from cognitive science, in order for bottom-up cognitive processes to emerge, much like they do for Micronesian navigators who are feeling their way across the ocean through the soles of their feet, so to speak. As I talked about at the beginning of my talk, I don't know if you had...
Just one last question related to that. You mentioned always jazz, but I was thinking more in group Nuova Consonanza in Italy in the 60s, 70s, or AIM in England in the 72, or Derry Bailey. That is another aspect of improvisations, no? That is kind of different from jazz. For me, at least, it's different from jazz, this kind of improvisations, aspects of how they relate in cognitive of the sound, how the sound is no? It's yeah. Manifestation of these improvisations. Yeah.
Well, the anthropologist who did the research on Micronesian sailors is a guy named Edwin Hutchins. And he's now drifted into cognitive science, and he has a whole lab at the University of California, San Diego now, supporting his project. And as part of his MacArthur Genius Grant recipient award, he did a study of top-down Western navigational cognition in a helicopter carrier, which had entered into San Diego Harbor, into the canal, or the, you know, the strait, into the harbor. And it's, I don't know whether he set this up deliberately or not, but the ship experiences massive systems failure. And so then he does a video account of the navigation team, who has to hearken back to an earlier moment, 100 years earlier in the history of navigational cognition, in order to figure out how to keep the ship from going aground, because, as he says sardonically, careers as well as lives are at stake. And what he does, what he did is was really important, because it showed the vulnerability of ships that relied on a mainframe navigator, a mainframe computer, for a computational navigation, because if an exojet missile hits that ship and knocks out the mainframe, the ship is absolutely helpless. And so it forced the Navy to consider massive replication of computer resources and decentralizing it, so that the ship is not vulnerable to massive systems failure, which is one of the features of top-down computation, generally speaking, which is part and parcel of Western European thinking. And so it's a really wonderful study. So you can find his work on the difference between Western navigation and Micronesian navigation through his work in anthropology. And then he's got this wonderful book called Cognition in the Wild, which came out from MIT in 1995. I just happen to know, and highly recommend, because it's you know, hilarious on one line, on one level, mind blowing, and basically shows you how vulnerable we are in the way that we think, as well as our institutions, not to mention the Navy, to massive systems failure. And globally, we're experiencing this directly right now, which makes, I find Edward Hutchinson's work really fascinating for the point of reorganizing human society in a way that is perhaps more life-affirming. But that's a whole other question. Now, Sarush, yeah. Sarush has a question. Sarush, I think.
Hello? You need to, oh,
yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you want to highlight your video so we can see it?
I guess I can, but the internet connection is so bad, I don't think. Okay, so can you see me?
Yeah, that's good enough. Yeah.
Okay. So it was amazing, as it was last time, and I learned a lot. I guess my video, do you see anything? Because it keeps...
No, I'm seeing you fine. I mean, it's a little unstable, but it's fine.
Okay. So I'm sorry for that. So again, thank you very much. As I did last time, maybe I want to take this into more, I don't know, stuff that comes to my mind. First of all, there's the idea of a rhythm and then bifurcation. I guess which came up at some point, which reminds me of I mean, these are main categories in concepts in, for example, Bergsonian ontology, as Deleuze talks about it. So being is like a rhythm, and then it bifurcates into more differentiated states. So again, this brings me back to your talk about this topic. Again, then we have the idea of the continuum, which comes from Leibniz. And when you were talking about the notes and the melodies,
well, it's much older. Let me just interrupt. It's much older than Leibniz. Uh-huh. I mean, this goes all the way back, and the fight over the nature of the continuum is really that takes place in Greece. It takes place among Jewish philosophers and theologians. It takes place all through medieval Renaissance, and is central. I mean, that's really what Spinoza is talking about in terms of substance, although his sense of substance as non-divisible would differ him from Leibniz, which is based on the calculus, really. I mean, it's really an infinite series of still points.
Yes.
On the continuum. That's Leibniz.
Now, what makes it more fascinating about your talk is that when we talk about jazz and music and stuff, inside maybe this context, what can we make of improvisation in this context? I mean, in such an ontology, which is an important part of jazz, as you mentioned. And you talked about alternating between layers of time, I guess, at some point. But I guess this is what I get from this. How is this, translatable to improvisation, and then... this brings us maybe back to ontology and ethics, maybe, I mean, politics. So yeah. how does the subject manipulate this? Okay, yes, go on.
Well, first of all, the talk on October 4th, which is really a discussion, and the background reading for that is a short essay that I have called The Gift of Silence. Which is up there. And so in that essay, I address the micro-political implications of cognitive bifurcation. So, but in this context, I'm talking about music no longer a determined trajectory that's mapped out by the composer who exists outside of time and determine what's going to happen when in the context of a music score. During jazz improvisation, while they may refer to a music score, every instant is a field of all possibilities. And I describe the possibilities in terms of four dimensions: melody, harmony, harmonic rhythm, percussive rhythm. and that jazz musicians are aware of all dimensions at every moment in the process of improvising. And they're responding to what's going on around them in all those dimensions.
I see.
And because they share a continuum, then the question of how does the continuum enable these spontaneous bifurcations? And that's really at the heart of my interest in the neurophenomenology or the cognitive neuroscience of jazz improvisation, which is what I'll discuss on next Saturday, based on the essay that I have up there called Jazz's Narrative, where I go into the cognitive neuroscience, both theoretically and in terms of empirical evidence about jazz and cognition, or music and cognition generally.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Shreya?
Hi. That was an amazing presentation. Thank you so much for that. And I was wondering actually about the example you were giving about the Micronesian culture and how they sense through their feet, because this is sort of a tangential question or comment, but I listened to a lecture recently where they explained that one of the ways of navigation and wayfinding in Micronesian culture was also through the crafting of their canoes. And when you were talking about the neurocognition experience of jazz improvisation, I was also then, you did mention it maybe briefly, but maybe I wasn't paying attention, but I'm wondering about the crafting of tools and how that also maybe feeds into the jazz improv ability.
Well, that's a really interesting question. And what I'm hoping next week is also to talk about how instruments shape the proprioceptive pathways. In other words, I'm going to suggest that instruments have non-human agency in the shaping of proprioceptive pathways, so that a clarinetist and a vibraphonist and a drummer and a pianist and a guitarist and a flutist and a saxophonist all have very different proprioceptive pathways, but those pathways are shaped by the instruments, even though they're speaking the same language. If you understand what I'm saying. So that's a really incredibly interesting question. And perhaps maybe if we could postpone addressing that till next Saturday, that would be really wonderful. Do you have a follow-up question aside from that? But I would really encourage you to get interested in the work of Edwin Hutchins here, because he was the anthropologist who did the initial research in the 60s, I think, on and early 70s on Micronesian sailors. Navigators, and the navigators were considered shaman. They considered holy men because of their abilities to do this. Because if you think about their achievements in sailing, you know, thousands of miles out of sight of land with no sextants, no GPS systems, you know, just sail and row and rowing at the mercy of the elements, and they're able to reach their destination, which is fixed in their mind through cultural memory. So we're talking about distributed cognition as well as embodied cognition of the shamans. It's really a fascinating topic. And I was just using that as an analogy to show the difference in the ways in which jazz musicians versus classical musicians experience the world and experience time and are therefore and that the assumptions about the nature of time and the ways in which classical musicians experience time make them less likely to learn how to play jazz than jazz musicians are able to learn classical music. And why does that seem to be? It's not completely true, because there's a guy here in town I've been trying to interview named Jeff Grubbs, who's a bassist with the Pittsburgh Symphony and also a really great jazz bassist. So he's actually able to straddle both worlds. And or you get, you know, Indian and jazz fusion. I'm a big fan of John McLaughlin and Shakti, and even the earlier ensemble that I had of the acoustic version of Mahavishnu Orchestra from, I think, 1968, which had Dave Liebman on soprano saxophone, but also El Shankara, the Shankara, the nephew of Ravi Shankar. I mean, it was really, I mean, that's one of the reasons why I got into jazz, as I heard that and said, you know. So the fusion is a really wonderful topic, and unfortunately I'm not skilled enough to be able to play like that, so I stick to mainstream jazz for the most part, unless I can get people willing to put up with my noodling and play free jazz.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else? Any other questions? Well, David, did you want to add something?
I don't think so. I mean, I'm still sort of mulling over this idea of the continuum, because I don't know if I'm a continuum skeptic. I'm kind of skeptical. Maybe I'm a little skeptical about whether this is a kind of phenomenological kind of or intuitive grasp of the continuum. At least in mathematical terms, it seems to imply a kind of grasp of of hyper infinities, you know. I mean, you know, if you just think about the real number continuum in terms of, you know, set theoretical cardinality.
Yeah, I don't know if you caught my joke about hyper infinity an unnecessary repetition, because infinity is by nature hyper, because it has in all places and one time, in all places, in all possible places and at all times. And that's very stressful.
I was thinking a remark I heard Rocco Gangle make in, I think it was on Machinic Unconscious Happy Hour, where he's kind of talking about the sort of the conditions for articulation or inscription, you know, just making a difference between one thing and another. And he pointed out, I mean, like metaphysically, that seems to imply always a milieu, which is, if you like, not yet differentiated.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm inclined to vacillate on this issue, like most issues, probably. But I guess you're going to come at this next week. You know, I mean, I wonder if there might be ways in which we could potentially explain some of these behaviors in terms of discrete processes,
right?
Even though they're sub-representational. So there's on the one hand the issue between concepts or representations and sub-representational cognitive processes, and on the other hand between, if you like, infinite continuous and discrete processes. And that would be interesting to sort of, since we've raised the ontological issue.
Yeah.
And I think if we're kind of invoking Deleuze or Bergson, those are, you know, inescapable.
Yeah. Or Whitehead or Spinoza.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it would be good to get into that next week. But
Well, you know me, I'm a metaphor guy.
Yeah.
And it seems to me that in order to describe the palpable field of improvisation, which could be described in terms of flow within an individual and groove amongst the members of an ensemble, that it provides an interesting local version of a felt continuum. Beyond that, I'm not a trained philosopher. I'm really interested in the concept of immanence and the history of it. In the physics of Bohm and Prigogine, going all the way back to Spinoza and even before. And I'm reading, ancient and medieval theories of time and right now just trying to map out what the history is here. But in terms of having anything philosophically to say about its ontological stability, I'm incompetent, I would say.
Well, so it's a grease pig that we can return to wrestling with next week.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm happy to contribute my deviating line of flight into the field of all possible worlds. So, anything else?
Fine.
So we're now past 2 hours. I don't know how much more you guys can stand of this. I really appreciate your indulgence here, obviously. I really appreciate you folks listening. If there's any other questions or comments or vituperative statements that you'd like to state, I'm all ears.
Hi,
how are you, Anton?
Hi, I'm fine, thank you. The talk was absolutely wonderful. I especially love the input of the conference of birds, and about that, it's a silly question of our ideas about navigation and the shaman within the boat. Let's say we translate that the shaman is the jazz band sensing, but they are not on the sea, they are in time, in dirt time. But I have a question or a proposition about what would be then an armada or a synchronic aspect of multiple jazz band sensing different time within a topology. Would it be an interesting pathway to explore into this reverberating system of multiple agents that sense and congruate within times and crises, and then that extend the perimeter of it's not cognition, but it's, let's say, it's reverberation of presence and immanence. Would it be something that we could expand throughout the activity of music making?
Well, it sounds like you'll fit in with David's rubric pretty nicely. I do talk about next, and I will talk about next Saturday, about what are the implications of an embodied cognition becoming distributed.
Wonderful.
Within an ensemble. Now, to talk about multiple ensembles, above my pay grade, to make a joke of it. I don't know where to go from there. But there is another dimension for October 4th, which has to do with the micro-political implications of what it is that I'm saying here in terms of embodied cognition, in terms of cognitive bifurcations. And we haven't even begun to talk about cognitive aggregations, which Love Supreme is a supreme example of, and I didn't get a chance to talk about that either, or to talk about Harmelotics or the Art Ensemble of Chicago and and more recent manifestations of people who are thinking seriously and theoretically about what goes on in jazz in time.
Okay, we'll love to hear this.
So maybe we could postpone those questions for this coming Saturday.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Anything else? Renzo says something about this example makes me think of the notion of cybernetics. And absolutely, as you know, the work of Prigogine and the work of Wiener and Shannon come together in second order cybernetics and what becomes general systems theory. And the idea even of culture as a self-organization from noise is something that, for example, my dissertation advisor, who happened to show up on campus just when I needed him, wrote about. And that's William R. Paulson, who wrote a book called The Noise of Culture. It came out in 1986 from Cornell. And that's a really wonderful book. And I talk about information theory and cognition when I talk about the multiplicity of cognitions of time that occur simultaneously and the fact that sometimes they amplify, but sometimes they can interfere with each other. And that's, for example, why jazz musicians get lost, because literally these two forms of time cognition interfere, create interference patterns, and make it really difficult for the jazz musician to function. And I actually talk about that. I'll talk about that next Saturday. So that's a point where, you know, the cognitive neuroscience and cybernetics seem to come together in interesting ways. Oh, Eric Sussoff, Shreya. Shreya, that would be Eric Sussoff, S-U-S-O-E-F-F.
Oh, cool, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. A wonderful guy, not the least of which is because he put up with me as a student.
Thanks so much, Martin. I'm going to go and heat some pasta and uncork some wine, I think. But I'm really looking forward to the sequel.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, David, for showing up. Yeah, on the call of duty, my friend.
No, not at all. Great to see you as well. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, David, for joining us.
Bye, Sepideh.
Bye, bye.
See you next week.
This was fun for me, and I hope it was for everybody else.